my big gray submarine. You remember the episode of me digging the trench. Well, the company finally brought my propane tank, and they said it, you know, it was the best experience I've had with the business in so long. Such a great balance to the experience I had with its competition. And this is a great tank. And one of the nice things about it is I got this tank. I got all the accessories for it, the tubing, all the fun stuff for just the price of what the other company wanted to charge me for installation alone. Yeah. And they had propane on sale. So I bought, I think it was 1,900 gallons pre-bought. So I got an extra discount. So now they're holding on to 1,900 gallons of propane. So I can stay as toasty as I want all winter long. And that just made me happy. And the cool thing is get this. Okay, one last thing about propane, and I won't talk any more about it, okay? Well, last night I came out of the house, and I was letting a rascal out, and I smelled propane. And I thought, okay, I shouldn't be smelling propane outside. That's not good. And so I came over to the tank, and I heard a little bit of a hiss. And it was coming from one of these valves that are installed. And I panicked. I thought, ah, what do you do? You know, do I call 911? Do I call the police? Do I call the hospital? Do I call my mom? What do I do? There's a propane leak. So I called the company, and they were closed. But the nice thing is, the owner had given me his card, and it has his cell phone number. You can reach him day or night. How many companies do you know where you can actually reach the owner of the company 24 hours a day? Not too awful many. Try calling AT&T or try calling your local Walmart or something like that. Ain't gonna happen. But anyway, he answered his phone. He got somebody over here pronto who tightened up the valve. No problem. It was a minor thing, but you know, with me, I don't know. I'm not a professional. All I knew is that maybe I should pack up, you know, because I've heard of propane tanks exploding, you know, and it basically just leaves a crater where you once lived. And as much as I like craters, I don't want to live in one. So, hey, I said, hey, want to go pick apples? Let's go. He's wet and cold, but he's with Daddy, and that's all that matters. You know, so that was a good deal. You know, one of the things I wanted to mention on my way to picking apples is that my lawn, of course, you can notice that it does look kind of unkempt. Unkempt. I like using that word. Unkempt. And it's very, very long. I do that on purpose. There is a reason for what I'm doing here. When for those of you that do have lawns and also that want to make sure that your lawns are as healthy as possible, sometimes it's a little bit difficult, you know? Sometimes you're wondering, like, do I use fertilizers? Do I don't use fertilizers? Do I mow it? How short do I mow it? What are all these things? And not a whole lot of gardening channels out there discuss lawns. You know, most gardening channels are like, rip up your lawn, throw in a raised bed. Not all of us want to do that, you know? Some of us want a lawn. Some of us want a raised bed. Some of us want both of those. You know, we want it all. Yes, we do. And what I do with my lawn in the fall is towards the end of summer, I give it one last mowing, and then I let it grow a little bit tall. And you'll notice in the autumn, those of us who have an actual winter, not the people down south, but people who actually have cold weather, your grass will stop growing in the fall, and then it'll slowly die off for the winter. Well, I like to leave my lawn really tall. This is around maybe 8 inches tall. It seems awful tall, but the reason is that towards the end of the season, grass likes to go to seed. And if you keep mowing it, it doesn't go to seed. It's nice to have that extra boost because all this grass went to seed, all the seeds are dropping in the grass, and all the little weeds that are part of my lawn, because I don't grow just grass. This is not just grass. This is dandelions, and this is grass, and it has all kinds of mystery stuff in it to make a lawn. That's why it's such a well-balanced lawn. I like that. And I leave it tall because what happens is the grass dies and it forms like this light insulating mat, and that will insulate the roots of the grass, because grass generally does not have super deep roots. It has shallower roots. Some of it does, some of it doesn't. So this forms an insulating mat, and then in the spring when the snow goes away, I give it a mowing. It clears off the grass and the new stuff comes up really nice. But if you mow it really short, it looks really nice, but sometimes if you have a really harsh winter and a really cold time, it can kill off parts of your lawn or stunt it when it kills off the roots. So there's a little tip from me to you if you want to help your lawn out a little bit. Let it go, you know, in the autumn, you know, walk on the wild side here. Let your lawn go a little bit. It's okay. It's going to be just fine. Hey, look, I got a box. And no, I am not going to play lacrosse. Look at this. Look at this up close. This is an apple picker. Yep, it's that time. Yes, sirree. Crackhead and I are going to go pick apples. He's just so happy to be out here. He runs like Pepe Le Pew. He just bounds through the grass. And, you know, that's another thing. Rascal, oh, where are you? Oh, Rascal loves tall grass as much as I do. I like kicking it around and stuff like that. I don't know. I guess I never really grew up. I just like kicking it around and seeing all the stuff that's growing. And the chickens love it. The chickens are walking through this grass just having the best time. And, okay. There's a part that I normally would edit out. I'm in the middle of a sentence, and I do this, and people that get older, you're in the middle of a sentence, and then you just totally forget what the heck you were saying. I don't know what I was talking about. Okay, well, apparently it wasn't important. Hopefully I'm not radioactive or something, but whatever it was, I guess if it's important, I'll figure it out again. Hey, it's time to pick apples. Something I can remember to do. Come on over here and take a look at the apples. I haven't shown you the apple tree in a while. They're actually quite ripe. That's a lot of apples, no matter how you slice and dice it. That's a lot of apples. And I'm very happy about that. But as many as you think are on the tree, take a look below it. Oh, there are endless apples here. And you got to be very careful where you walk around this tree. Otherwise, like I mentioned, you go zing and you're out of here. And although these do look good, if you pick one of these up, you're like, oh, that looks good. And then you flip it over. And let me take my glove off. It's got a soft spot right here. And that's what happens when apples fall off a tree. They're hitting that hard ground. And when you hit an apple, it bruises. When I was picking apples in Washington State with my dad, that was one of the big things, the big no-no. You do not bump those apples. When you put them in the bag that you have around your chest hanging down in front of you, you gently put them in there. And then when you put them in the large wooden bins, you gently roll them out. Because if you hit an apple like this, there, that's going to be a bruise. It's going to get a soft spot. And it's going to start rotting. It basically kills the flesh. It's kind of like a bruise on your hand, only it doesn't heal. And so this apple is good for feeding to the chickens, to the squirrels, all that stuff, but it definitely is not good for feeding to you unless you eat it right then and there. But I don't need to eat the apples off the ground. Although I could, I have more than enough apples for me up on the tree. And while I'm picking apples, Fearless Hunter, he cornered something in here, and I think it's a mouse inside this, I don't know what it is, some kind of dead bush, but Rascal's up to his shoulders in this, and he's digging away like a little badger dog. He'll never catch it. Whatever it is, he'll never catch it, but that never stops him, you know? He's always got those high hopes that he's going to catch stuff, and he's always got something to do out here. This is the weirdest thing, though. I bought this, and it didn't cost very much, and I wish I knew how much it cost. It's basically just got the metal hooks here and a basket, and it's got this little cushion, and you put it in here, and it catches the apples and keeps them from bruising, and you can pick a few apples at a time, and boy, howdy, look at this. Yep, this thing goes way, and then you just tighten this up, and you can reach way the heck up there where you normally couldn't reach with your hands. How cool is that? No ladders. And I told you about the bad experience I've had with ladders, so no, you don't want to get me up on a ladder. But I decided to pick a few apples today because I want to send some to my mom. I have so many apples, I don't even know what to do with them. I've made canned apples, I've made apple sauce, I'm going to make some apple butter. But my mom, when I told her I had Honeycrisp apples, she goes, oh. And so I thought, my mom lives in Nebraska. I live in Iowa. So I'm going to pack some, a half a dozen of them into a box and send her some. My sister also lives in the same town. So I'm going to pack some into a box and send them to her. But I want to pick my best ones for my family. And so that's why I want to reach way the heck up there, because I've eaten all the ones down here, and there are some that aren't quite as ripe yet. When they're a little tan on one side, they're not quite as ripe, but the totally red ones. And with the cold weather we're having, it is bringing out the sugars in these apples. I'm gonna pick these, pack them in bubble wrap, and ship them, like 2-day shipping, and make sure they get some fresh apples. So let's pick some apples. Now, the way I operate this thing probably isn't the way it's supposed to be operated, but I don't care. I just take the claws, reach them around an apple, and give a gentle tug. Ah! One for the basket, one for my head. Oh, that felt good. Okay, well, that's the apple I'm gonna eat, the one that falls. The ones that fall and hit the ground, I set aside because I know that they're not gonna last. And I eat those ones that day or the next day, or I use them for processing. Okay, come on down. Oh, there's another good one. I hope you're watching this, Mom. This is how your apples were picked. My mom actually goes onto my Facebook and watches my videos. That's kind of weird, having your family tuning in and see how you do things. I'm showing you how not to do that, but this is how I pick apples. Yep, that's how it's done. Aha, there's a couple left over here. This little tree behind the Honeycrisp, this is, I believe, a Granny Smith, not quite sure. Whatever it is, it's a green apple, and it's tart. Wonderful for baking. I don't need apples 25 feet up in the air. I really don't. I mean, it's not doing me any good. And so all of those upper ones are coming off, and I'm gonna start training this tree to go out laterally with strong branches. That way I can just come in and go, hey, apple, oh, hey, apple. That's what I want. If I want a tree for looks, I'm gonna grow this. If I'm gonna grow a tree for me, for production, for eating, which is what I wanna do with this tree, that's what I'm gonna have to do. And it's gonna take a chainsaw, it's gonna take some pruners, and you're gonna be really wincing a lot with me too, because I really don't wanna do this, but I have to. So apple pruning season coming up. I haven't forgotten. A lot of people wanted to go through this with me and see how I do it. I'm gonna show you how I do it, okay? Not how the pros do it, but how I do it. I'm gonna prune this one and also the Granny Smith over there, because that one really needs it. It was in the wild for the longest time. Whoever used to live here just let that grow wild, and there was weeds and little trees growing up and pushing it all over the place, and they had put one of those collars around the base of it, and the tree had gone wild and grew around it, so it kind of warped the tree a little bit. Yeah, it was really kind of sad. But yeah, this tree is gonna look a lot better. Next year, it's gonna look ugly, but the year after that, the new growth is gonna come out, and then we're gonna start getting some really good production. Okay, I think I'm pretty much done filming for today. I'm gonna take some time for myself and Rascal. I don't know where he went. I'm gonna take some time and get some really nice apples for my mom and for my sister and get them off in the mail. So Mom, if you're watching, your apples are on the way. I'll talk to you all soon. Thanks for joining me. I really appreciate it. Have a great day. Bye.